Chair. So the board requested a personal story to be presented at this meeting to illustrate some of the partnership work around integration that we're doing for people with learning disabilities. So I focused on a new service that we've jointly commissioned and jointly funded for people with learning disability, and particularly on a young man I'm going to call John. Okay. So this new service was developed in partnership with World Health and Care Commissioning Services and the Regard Group, who are an independent care provider. And this was after the need for bespoke service was identified to meet the needs of a small number of people who've got very complex needs who live in a borough, particularly those being discharged from assessment and treatment units in hospital environments. So this service is a purpose-built supported living accommodation that has six separate apartments. It's funded from a pool budget in terms of the care that's provided on site. Each apartment is designed with the people that we support in mind, and lots of factors have gone into the design and layout. So each apartment is self-contained, and there are three common lawn areas and separate safe garden spaces outside for people to enjoy. Compatibility between the people that have moved in is carefully considered, and the environmental adjustments that each of them may need has also been considered. So things such as soundproofing, particular furnishings and fittings have been carefully chosen. All staff in this service complete a bespoke training package covering all the specific needs of the people that are supported there, so that they get to know the people and get to know them before they move in, and then continue to work with them and get to know them once they've moved in. So that's a bit of background around the service where John now lives, and I'll talk a little bit about John now. So he's a young man with a wicked sense of humour. He has a diagnosis of autistic spectrum disorder, learning disability and epilepsy. He has complex needs, including sensory needs, and he can present with very challenging behaviours in the form of physical aggression towards other people, and also he can damage property if he's not supported properly. This is more likely to happen when he's supported in the wrong type of environment, and where his needs are not anticipated and aren't met properly by his care team, care staff that know him well and know how to respond to him. Following a placement breakdown at his previous home and an incident in the community last year, John was actually detained under the Mental Health Act and he was treated in hospital since April 2018. He moved into his new service in spring 2019. He's achieved much more than anybody could have anticipated in the short time that he's lived there. He's settled in very well and he's made progress in many areas. And it's important to recognise that small changes are a really big thing for John and make a big difference to his experience of life. So some examples: he allows staff to spend more and more time in his personal space. Initially, when he moved in, he would tolerate only 10 minutes of staff time, and he'd only let that happen a small number of times each day, so it was very difficult for staff to provide the care and interaction that he needs because they couldn't get close to him. He will now tolerate up to an hour of staff time, and they're supporting him in his own apartment, in his own safe place. His team eat meals with him and help him to relax and feel safe in the comfort of his own flat, and this is improving his mood and well-being. He has choice at every opportunity. He's now able to control his day-to-day activities more, choosing the things he wants to do, when he wants to do things, and not have to do things when he doesn't want to do them. And this has drastically reduced the behaviours that he's previously experienced. It's far more personalised. He does go out into the community regularly. He goes out every day, more or less, in his mobility car. He used to just go with the driver and be driven around. Now he gets out at a small shop, he buys a drink and snacks, he'll wait patiently in a queue alongside other people, and he will pay for items and take the change himself. This is a big step forward for him. He's choosing what he wants to buy, and he's using his own money to pay for it. The cashiers have now got to know him, and know his name and talk to him. He's comfortable and feels safe to do this. Also, when he's out with his driver, he gets out at the park and he enjoys the park equipment. He's been running and exercising in the park, and this is supporting him to lose some weight. He's weighed every week and is losing weight consistently as part of his personal support plan. He has a balanced, healthy diet, and he's reduced the amount of times he asks for additional and healthy snacks. Another issue is that he wouldn't have his hair cut, so for many years, John wouldn't have his hair cut. So since moving to the new service, he now has a hairdresser that comes to him in his flat, and he lets them style and cut his hair for him. He lets it happen, he looks fantastic, and enjoys the visits from the hairdresser. He takes pride in his apartment, he helps the staff with his daily household tasks, he even cuts the grass for his own garden, he's hoovering, he's making his bed, and he's washing the pots after he has something to eat. He can make one or two things in the kitchen himself, and he's washing up after himself. He goes to bed when he feels like it, and when he gets up, he'll make the bed after himself, usually. There have also been issues about general health care, and we've talked previously in this board about the need for people to have annual health checks and increase the general health monitoring that people have. A particular issue for John is dental care. He's been supported to have a dental check, and now it's been identified that he needs some dental treatment and has a plan for him to have that. He's also had an MDT, multidisciplinary team, look at his overall health and identified that he needed blood tests, which he hasn't had for some time. He's had the test, which was successful, so this is a big step forward. So this will support John to continue to access the health services that he requires, within reasonable adjustments that may need to be made to help him to do so. So that's a bit about John and the way that he's thrived in his new accommodation. We asked his mum and dad, they say they visit him much more often. John's got more contact with his sisters and his nephew, and he's clearly very close to them. John's parents advocate for him, and they said how pleased they are about how well he's settled into his new home. They're happy with the service. They particularly commented on the transition from hospital to his new home and how this was undertaken by the staff involved. John's mother said that the care team appeared to have been very well matched and well suited to John and knowing how to support him. John's father commented, he stated that the family couldn't be happier, he settled really well, and I can't fault regard to the provider for how they are managing. John's social worker has also noticed a big difference. He said in his opinion, John's move to his new home has been a very positive experience for him. He's settled well. The incidents of behaviour that previously were problematic for him have been very well managed by his care team. Sensory equipment that he benefits from has been purchased using the Transforming Care branch of NHS England, and this provides him with some suitably stimulating activity. At first, he'd only be except being driven around, and now, as we've heard, he's actually getting out, getting to the shops, getting to the park and benefiting from community life. So this is an example of how working together is making a real difference to people's lives, and we hope that John will continue to thrive in his new home. John isn't his real name, obviously, when he writes this. So I'm happy to take any questions on that if there are any.
Thank you for giving me an opportunity to say a few words regarding. Chair and members of the committee. Thank you for giving me an opportunity to say a few words regarding the proposals for urgent care services in Wirral. At the outset, I wish to declare my practice's interest as a provider of minor injury services from Miriam Medical Centre and Gladstone Medical Centre, previously in Parkville Medical Centre. As it's been recorded, same Miriam Minor Injuries and Walk-in Services campaign was coordinated through our practice, our patient groups, and was supported by thousands of people in Wirral. Our campaign worked alongside other groups who were also interested to save the services in our community. At the outset, let me clarify a few issues. Our campaign was apolitical, and we are grateful for the unanimous support of the Wirral Borough Council and all the councillors and MPs from all parties and all sections within various political parties. We consistently maintain that we were not opposed to the establishment of the proposed urgent treatment centre in Wirral. We recognise that the services in the community needed to be streamlined, and we were prepared to work with the CCG in these efforts. However, we were opposed to the closure of well-used walk-in centres and minor injury services that were open 365 days a year. We were opposed to the closure of walk-in services and replaced them with development of services for dressings and by appointments only. And we were also opposed to restricting the services for patients up to the age of 19 only. The campaign had an overwhelming support of the people of Wirral, and over 45,000 people supporting various petitions. First of all, we welcome the H report as it truly reflects the views of the people of Wirral and all stakeholders. We have considered the proposals of the CCG, which are being presented for approval by the committee today. We recognise that this means closure of one of the services provided by Miriam Primary Care Group at Gladstone Medical Centre. We support the proposal of the Wirral CCG for the following reasons: that they will meet the concerns expressed by the people of Wirral, that they will ensure that there is a 24-hour urgent treatment centre, it will ensure that all substantive services are kept open in the community, they will be open for all age groups and will be on a walk-in basis, and community-based services can deliver innovation by facilitating some pre-bookable appointments, dressing slots, and introduce new services. We want to thank the CCG for having listened to the views of the people of Wirral and drastically reversed their original proposals and presented a new approach that will build on existing community services and at the same time develop a new urgent treatment centre for the people of Wirral. We support these proposals because they are in the best interest of the people of Wirral, and we have that message. Thank you.
Listen to the people of Wirral and do the right thing. Thank you. over to Nesta now to talk us through the paper, and we can have a discussion thereafter.
Thank you, Chair. I'm going to take that people have read the paper in detail, particularly the appendix, so I'm just going to go through the front paper and the recommendation that we're asking that the body to sign on today. So just in terms of background to this, so the transformation for urgent care on the law has been a priority for some years, and in fact some early engagement was started as far back as 10 years ago. So it's been something that Wirral has been that need to look at how we could improve the current pathways for people. And I think what we've got to keep in our minds is that the overall need for us to do this was to make sure that while we meet the constitutional standard, of which there are some clinical evidence for, and then also about getting that excellence in clinical quality and also the sustainability of as a system going forward. The background for this, you can read it in the Case for Change. It talks a lot about all of the engagement work that was done and what the activity, when we've looked at who was going where and for what reason, what that showed us. The walk-in centres, for example, were predominantly younger people were using them from the ages of 20 to 29. So that modelling also showed us when we looked at the activity that people going to our part to the A&E department there, about 50% in 2016-17 were actually classed as minor. So these were people that were going there that actually could have been seen elsewhere but were defaulting to use there. Governing Body will note that in February 2018 we made the decision that we would host the urgent treatment centre. Because whilst that was mandated nationally, we wanted to have that decision, what made the best sense for us on Wirral and for the people here. And because of all of the reasons, not only were those people that we knew that were going to be out of park sites, but there's also other clinical reasons why it needs to be there in terms of the access to diagnostics and then also that urgent referral upwards into the A&E department. So that decision was made in February 2018. We then went out to consult on what the option could be in order to support the urgent treatment centre and what the community offer to look like. People had told us before in all of that engagement work that while some people were very clear where they needed to go, others weren't clear. And I think when we looked at what we were commissioning, they were on very different towers, everything was called different terms, which I've already heard already today. So we weren't calling the same things as well. So it was no wonder that people were telling us, well, I'm a bit confused, I don't know where I should go. So those final options were put out to consultation, and it looked at whether we needed a 24-hour urgent treatment centre on the Isle of Man's like 15 hours, and then we looked at what that community office should be. We analysed why people were going to the walk-in centres and the minor injury units, which is why those options were came up with. The original one that we looked at was to have the dressing clinics, and people said they wanted somewhere where they could take young people, children and young people, to access urgent treatment, so treatment that they couldn't wait for. So we've worked in line with all of our due processes, and that formal consultation started in September last year and finished in December. We had a lot of campaigning activity which was really positive, and I think we as an organisation we really welcome that, because we need to listen to the views of people. When you're engaging with people, you try and engage with as wide range as possible, and the campaigning that happened was really beneficial because it has helped us to come up with our recommendations today. Alongside that, we've had, as part of this, we've had the Clinical Senate from Greater Manchester come to review our model and to look at what they thought about what we were offering. And in their visit that they had here, they also felt that it was a bit confusing and that things could be joined up a lot better. And they made some recommendations, which we've already been working with our stakeholders to progress with them. So for example, we've already had our Clinical Innovations Day, which was a really good day earlier in this year. So as part of the end of the consultation, asked quite rightly, and it was very good that we had an independent analysis of responses to our survey, but as has already been said, we had over 45,000 signatures to the campaign, which was about keeping that all-age walk-in facilities in the community. As part of the consultation, we also had alternative proposals, which we also reviewed, and you can see them in the business case as well. So after consideration of all of that, which you'll see all of the detail in the business case, looking at the modelling of activity, of the workforce, ensuring that it was affordable, so we haven't reduced the financial model for this at all. The financial number linked to these services is staying the same, so this has not been about us trying to save money in any way. This has been about how we can make things better for people. And that is absolutely the aim of our recommendations, is to improve the patient pathway and the experience, and to also meet our constitutional standards, particularly that 4-hour target. So if I take you through the overall recommendations, which I can say, and thank you for some of the support that was shown earlier by one of our providers. We've also had support from the local medical committee, and that's an organisation that supports all the rural GPs, and they're supportive of our recommendations. So, first of all, the first recommendation is the implementation of a 24-hour urgent treatment centre. In the business case, you'll see that there are some more evidence to reasons for that, and one of them is another area that has already implemented 24 hours, and actually as a result of that they are now the best place in the country for meeting that 4-hour urgent care, the constitutional standard. They're meeting that with the best, so, and that's the advice that they were keen on. That 24-hour access to a GP on the urgent treatment centre was key. So that's the first recommendation. The second one is that we want all-age walking access, and this is again in response to the campaign and the feedback that we've had, is that we want to continue with having the walk-in centres at Wallasey. So the Victoria Central Hospital will be from 8 till 8, and that's a reduction of 2 hours there for the current provision. But that's mirrored by an increase in the Birkenhead Medical Centre. So this is again all-age walk-in access, and that will be increased by 2 hours, which means that both those which have the busiest activities, so most people go to there, they'll have the same hours of opening as well. The South Rural, the Eastern Clinic, there's no change there, and again we've had to really look at, you know, the not value for money if you like, but we can't have an expensive resource of nurses sitting when there's only a couple of people coming in. So when we've looked at the activity at Eastern, we can't justify expanding beyond 12 to 8 hours, 12 gets up to 8 p.m. And for West Wirral, it'll be the urgent treatment centre at the Arrow Park site, which again we're saying will be a 24 hours access, which is an increase of another 10 hours. You'll have heard earlier that people's unhappiness with the next recommendation. So we're recommending that the Gladstone minor injury, which was formerly Parkfield, and the Morton minor injury, so these are not walking centres, these are minor injury and illnesses units, that these are replaced with access to other urgent appointments in the community. So for the Gladstone area, when we've looked at the activity, there's about 75 attendances a week. 60% of them were from the very local GP practices. 80% were mostly suitable, that they could have been dealt with either in primary care or pharmacy. And there will be 82 extended hours access appointments in that locality. As well as obviously there are 4 pharmacies in that locality for people to access. So in terms of what the reason why people were going to the Gladstone / Parkfield minor injuries unit, that will be more than sufficiently covered by the extended access. The revised 111 that's improving as it's going forward in terms them again were predominantly for primary care. They were very minor ailments, which you can see that are in the equality impact assessments. So about 80% were suitable for primary care in terms of nurse intervention. The 79% came from very local GPs, so it's very local. When we looked at the minor injuries appointments and then compared that to the urgent extended access appointments, there was a shortfall so there were 64 appointments. So we looked at, what's that gap? How can we ensure that those people in that locality are not losing out as a result of this? So 46% of activity going into the Morton minor injury was for dressings. So we're now going to propose, and we're working with that provider to look at, we'll be implementing, if the recommendations approved, is to put 4-hour clinics a week in, which will give an extra 58 appointments for dressings, typical dressings as well. So again, in terms of what currently people are accessing as 90 appointments, we'll be over supplying those appointments, if you like. And that is again with the 111 changes and the local pharmacy that they have as well. So I think that's sort of the recommendations in a snapshot. Obviously, I'm sure there'll be lots of questions that people have, and I'm happy to answer them with my clinical colleagues as well.
Thanks, Nesta. I'm going to open this up to our group here for comment and questions.
Thank you, Paula. I think I'd like to say big thank you for listening to people of the Wirral. As you know, Council were unanimously against the original recommendations, and I think to hear Dr. McGarney say that he is pleased with the recommendations is great. I think that the provision of services was extremely complicated for people. People didn't know whether they should put minor injuries to walk in to our park. I think the improvement in the 111 service is going to be really, really good. And as I understand it, Nesta, I think the service for people who need dressings in the Morton area will be an improvement in that they can book appointments rather than walk in and have to wait a long time.
Yes, absolutely, yeah, they will be able to book, because that was some of the feedback that we had, is that people go into the minor injuries or the walking centres for dressings and sometimes having to wait a long time before they were seen, so they will have, they'll be booked appointments as well.
More comments,
queries,
questions from the
that's my concern, really, and I try and mirror that across to our family and more.
seen in primary care or by a pharmacy, they will still need to travel to Harrow Park because that's where IUD is. And I think that's where the key issue is. Because obviously for Birkenhead and Womersey, the walk-in centres will be there. And I know that our council colleagues are going to be working with transport because we do need to look at this, because it's not just for urgent care, is it? It's for if you've got an outpatient appointment, it's really important that people access that health care when they need this. And if you can't get there because there's no public transport, that is an issue. So I think it's a collective response that we need to do, not just linked to urgent care or stress, though, because we need to make sure that there's transport. You know, when we're going for a 7 day a week offer for planned care, for the, you know, health care at the hospital, then we need to make sure that people can get there, not just if you've got a car, because that's an inequity, isn't it?
I've got two questions for you, listening to what Councillors Norbury and Jones said. So, in this paper, we've got additional services through the 24-hour urgent treatment centre, which is nationally mandated, it's a must-do. And this is all part of a nationally, we've had to respond to the national policy drive on this about the consolidation of these services. We've done the consultation, and we've come out with we need to retain walk-in access in three community hubs, for Wallasey, Birkenhead, South Wirral, and West Wirral have continued access to Harrow Park. So that constitutes effectively very little change. In fact, that's the retention of an existing walk-in access. So that actually means that we're positively able to step the national agenda, which has been about the closure of walking centres. We've said we need to hold them. So bear with me, I'm just going through a bit of a train of thought. We said we need to replace Gladstone and Morton with a different type of service. And what we've heard from Dr. Mangani is, as the provider of that service, there's an assurance from him in terms of his representation of our Miriam Primary Care Group that they are able to provide those services in a different way, through dressings, through booking appointments and so on. However, I've heard particularly around transportation, poverty and concerns about that as a service around Morton. So Morton, people going to Morton would access it now by transport from a friend on foot or public transport anyway. So they would still be accessing Morton on that basis. But really what I suppose in terms of that, I would like a similar level of assurance from the provider of the Morton service as we've had from the Gladstone service, that they're able to provide that level of access. So that's my first question around that. I just wondered if you answer that first.
Thank you. And yes, we have had initial discussions, so we obviously could make a recommendation and suggestion of an additional dressing clinic. And in those discussions we've said it's for Morton and there may be as well for West Wirral, but at the moment we can't justify it doesn't look like we need that activity there, that service to be provided. But yes, absolutely, they are able to do those dressing clinics for us.
My second question goes off a slight tangent in terms of subject to the governing body making a decision today on the recommendations in the report. What will be the next steps in terms of further scrutiny of that decision?
So there's a date been set for the Wirral overview scrutiny for 24th of July, and then we're waiting because West Cheshire patients come not only to Eastern actually, but to Harrow Park and Victoria. I'm not sure why they go that far, but they do. That we'll need a joint task as well for that scrutiny, but that date hasn't been set as yet, as far as I know.
Thanks, Simon. Councillor Usher, you
can talk about it. Thank you, Chair. This is my first Joint Strategic Commission Board, so thank you very much. I'm looking forward to working with you all. As been said already tonight, we do not vote on this decision because it's CCG funded, not part of the Joint really positive that the recommendations significantly move forward towards that view. However, there are still some concerns around Newcastle and Morton sites. And I hope that the changes that are proposed, if they pass through, then we monitor them to ensure that the alternative provisions put in place by means of GP appointments meet the need, and that people have access, ample access to an alternative site if they do need to access an alternative site. I think also everyone welcomes the idea of an urgent treatment centre to ensure that A and is coping with the pressure it faces, and it will increasingly face pressure over the coming years. And I think we also all agree that this ideally would have been an additional resource to the current provision, as opposed to an alternative to any current provision. Fortunately, for this to happen, additional resources have to be forthcoming. That's not necessarily the case. So I suppose just those comments, these